Hey guys, what's up? This is Mark with Puremix.net, and I am at Magic Garden Mastering with Brian Lucey. Brian is the man, many of you already know. Thanks for waiting for us, guys. We had a couple little delays. We are actually making some cables in order to give you guys the best possible audio quality that we could as we're demonstrating mastering. It's kind of a necessity. So one of the things that we had to do is create a bit of a Y-splitting cable to go from Brian's setup into our rig, but still get to his speakers without any loss. So, join with Brian. If you guys don't know his discography, it's pretty amazing. Lots of really vibey records. There's definitely a really consistent kind of
thing. Those are the more famous ones, you would say, the vibey ones.
Yeah. Recently, in the past, we'll cover those. Marilyn Manson, Arctic Monkeys, Cage the Elephant, The Black Keys, the last three records, amazing records.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Good team.
Yeah.
Chad Blake.
Any other ones that really stick out for you?
Oh gosh, I mean, I'm happy to have any record any day. I like the challenge of it, you know? Mm-hmm. Great records that are already really well done can be elevated, and records that need help can be elevated a lot easily, and I honestly like it all.
Yeah.
I don't say that as a politically correct answer. I just like to make things better. I like to make people happy. I like to work on music. So,
yeah.
The favorite record of the day the favorite record ever would be the record of the day. And today, when you leave, that will be. Can I say who it'll be? Let me think. Yeah, sure. I think I can say. I don't know. Let me think about
totally
that.
Totally okay.
Yeah. We'll come back to that. But yeah.
You actually, I'd like to point this out, you have a saying printed on your laptop over here.
I do.
If you guys can see that.
There you go, right to the point. Each single important, every record a career.
Kind of like that you have it right there.
I have it right there, all day, every day. And on this computer, which we've turned down mm-hmm. to make it easier to see your lovely self, each email an honor. It's important for me to, you know, sort of take each moment with the same appreciation that I would take any other moment. So to me, every client is valuable. Every record is valuable. I don't take a moment off. That's my sort of spiritual life. That's my work.
Yeah.
This isn't my work. This is fun.
Right.
The work for me is to get myself in a good place to work on music and to give it my all every day.
Yeah.
I mean, I had a client within the last year, you know, who was my one out of, you know, a few hundred, not exactly unhappy. He liked what I did. He just thought, he sort of assumed that because I was using the same basic chain for all the records that I was being lazy. And I said, no, this is my instrument. This mm-hmm. is what I use.
Yeah.
There's no lazy involved here, you know.
Yeah.
And we had that discussion. He didn't understand that, you know, sort of my whole mode as an artist is to be at a high level and to serve everyone equally. So mm-hmm. we had to sort of talk through that.
Yeah. Well, one of the things I like to do with these is kind of go back to the start and talk about even as far back as what was the first thing that got you into music? What was it that grabbed your heart and said,
oh, goodness. Well, I started playing guitar when I was 11. I played like Rolling Stones. My first record was Garden Party.
Mm-hmm.
And I had the Music Man soundtrack. That was my first 33. 45 was Garden Party. And, you know, I was playing Stone songs when I was 11, and then by the time I was, I taught myself how to play guitar first by listening to vinyl,
mm-hmm.
Blues, like all kinds of old blues, pretty much anyone you can think of that I could get a record. And then by college I was singing and playing covers,
mm-hmm.
and then I went to New York City and I started playing 6 nights a week with these Irish guys who are still friends. And
mm-hmm.
I was 20, they were 30, they seemed like they were ancient at the time. Now I'm like, oh yeah, that wasn't much, was it, 30? And I played with them 6 nights a week. I met them in Bleecker Street at an open mic one night. We were jamming in the bathroom, and then I saw them a couple days later, walking down the street, there they were, playing in a place called the Red Lion on Bleecker, and I played with them 6 nights a week.
Mm-hmm.
And so yeah, I mean, most, you know, you got 20 years of being a musician, somewhere along the line, I studied with Robert Fripp and Guitar Craft for basically 7 years. I just did a record for the California Guitar Trio. It's coming out soon. I think it's their 20th or 25th anniversary record.
Mm-hmm.
met those guys studying with Robert and Guitarcraft at different places around the country and rock bands. And then in the 90s, I started engineering my own stuff, and I had a lot of mentors, people I would just, you know, learn from before the era we're in now with everything being a computer and a plugin. It was a hardware studio. Mm-hmm. And then mastering came at the end of that in the late 90s. Mm-hmm. Wasn't something on my radar, but over time it just sort of took over my life and became something very satisfying and something fun and something that worked for other people. And this is the instrument I play, mm-hmm. you know?
Yeah.
No more singing, no more writing, although I jam with my friend John Miller occasionally. We improvise, but
yeah.
you know, it's just for fun.
Cool.
Yeah.
Well, so you had a full-blown analog studio at one point too, right?
I did. I had, it started out with a Soundcraft Ghost, and I had like Otari, like 8-track maybe, and then I had some 8-ats, and then eventually I had two MM-1200 16-track 2-inch machines. At one point they were strapped together, and that was kind of silly. But yeah, Neotech console, I got MCI console in there somewhere. I had a whole bunch of outboard, and yeah, I was doing records for friends and records for myself. I didn't like what was available at the time, with mm-hmm. all due respect to the people I was working with. Yeah. And I thought, well, I'll just figure this out. And so I'm self-taught, although no one's self-taught. You learn from the people that you hire, you learn from mm-hmm. your friends, you learn from the people around you. Yeah, right. So I started doing records for myself, records for my friends. And then the mastering thing was just, you know, in 1995, you had Bob Ludwig, you had, you know, Sterling Folk, you had, I don't know if Metropolis was around them, but you had these sort of A-level guys. And then you had guys for like $100 a song. Mm-hmm. And the $100 a song guy in 1995 was not doing it for me at all. And I couldn't afford maybe Bob Ludwig, who would have been the person I would have hired at the time. Yeah. So I just set out to do it myself. And I heard a sound, you know, growing up listening to vinyl and really hating the 80s and the sound, the thin sound and the sort of perfectionism, and really mm-hmm. not being very happy with the mid-rangey, hyper-compressed 90s. I wanted a sound for my music that to this day still carries over, although I'm a service provider for yeah. people. But I have a bias, if you will. You mm-hmm. know, I like drivers that move air. Yeah. I like low mid-range intimacy. I think that's the intimacy of music where it connects. And I like high-end that's clear but not over the top. Mm-hmm. You know, mastering that is what I call, you know, trying too hard, to me is a failure.
Right.
You know, the exciting parts of music are the song, the artist, the production. That's the exciting part. To me, the job of mastering is to then make it inviting for people to connect. Mm-hmm. To sort of offer it, as opposed to, like, you know, bang you over the head with it. Right. Now, that's not to say I don't do loud records. I do loud records if that's what's needed. Yeah. It's not a problem. But if I'm going to do a loud record, I still want it to move air on the bottom.
Yeah.
I still want it to feel human and have, you know, sort of emotionally bonding frequency and harmonic distortion elements.
Yeah.
You know, I don't want it to just sound like a product. Mm-hmm. I don't want it to feel like a product.
Yeah.
It's my feeling that people notice that. Mm-hmm. You know, my career is built on the idea that product music is disposable, and music that has engaging qualities is recognizable. Mm-hmm. That's why people, you know, heard what I did, which led to Brothers, and then after the Black Keys Brothers in 2010, obviously a lot more people had heard what I did.
But yeah.
I was doing the same thing before that. It just, as it is in this, you know, life, you are only as well known as the records are popular.
Yeah.
You know? So mm-hmm. I was doing the same thing before, and Dan and Pat heard that and liked it, and then now other yeah. people hear it.
That's Dan and Pat from the Black Keys. And
that's correct.
Yeah.
Pat Carney, Patrick Carney.
Do you want to talk a little bit about that record? And
I think it's a great record. I thought it was great when I heard it. I was very you know, honored to be given the opportunity to work on it. I'd never worked with Chad Blake.
Yeah.
And that was great.
You're a big fan of Chad's too, right?
Yeah, you know, yeah. I'm not a guy who knows all the producers in the world, you know. Yeah. There's a few names that I knew growing up, you know, producer books. You know, I liked, I knew Daniel Lenoir, I was aware of his stuff. Chad I was aware of, even going back to the Blake and Froom kind of era, all that stuff. But yeah, it was really nice working with those guys then, as it is now, because they are skilled, they're confident, but they're open.
Yeah.
They're humble. They're creative. They're co-creative. What I mean by creative is co-creative. They're, you know, example being, I've told this story before, you know, Chad had never worked with me, didn't know me from Adam, and he was like, hey, some mastering folks have said my stuff's a little hot. Do you want me to send it like down a dB? And I thought, well, that's quite a lot to offer me, given what he had done, and given the fact that he'd never heard of me. And I said, no, I just want what you guys think is great. Send me the ones that are exciting.
Yeah.
And he said, well, no, let me just send you the other one, just so you can see. So, you know, immediately there was a sense of rapport. Mm-hmm. It wasn't like, you know, I work for you and you work for me and this is the power struggle and all of our egos are invested. Mm-hmm. It was like, well, let's see what we can do together to make the coolest record.
Yeah.
And it's the same with Patrick and Dan and their whole team. You know, they run their whole thing the right way. Mm-hmm. And there are other people who do too. You know, the other day I met Keith Urban. I've never worked for him. But I met him and we talked and he told his life story. And you know, the way he runs his thing, you know, it feels the same as the way the Keys run it. So you know, there's good ways to run your business and good ways to run your creativity, and I'm blessed to work with a lot of people who do that. A lot of the labels I work with, a lot of the artists, working with them started a trend of getting in with a lot of good music and good people who were kind of making it fun.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah.
If that makes sense.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah. So not too recently now. I think you've been in Los Angeles for 3 years?
A little over 3 years, yeah.
Yeah. So what kind of, you know, gave you the push to just say, I'm going to try out Los Angeles and see what's happening there?
Well, I'm from Columbus, Ohio, as are you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I love Columbus, Ohio. I've got no issues with it. It's like right now probably the fastest growing city in America. It's on all these top 10 lists of cool places to be. I just thought, you know, I was successful, I was comfortable, and comfortable to me is not my favorite thing. I'm an artist at heart. I like to push.
Right.
I like to challenge myself. I like to stretch. And I'd come out here for some Grammy events and like a pre-party thing, and I was walking this red carpet and there was a older, like 70s, skinny, tall guy in Chuck Taylors and a suit. Mm-hmm. And he's walking by himself. And I'm the sort of person, if I see someone who seems, you know, like they're alone or whatever, I'll chat them up.
Yeah.
You know, because it was a social event and we were all walking from one place to another. And I said, oh, you know, what brings you out? He said, oh, it's my favorite day of the year, you know. And I took a few more steps. I was with my friend John Miller. And I turned back. I said, well, what is it you do? He said, well, I'm Jeff Emmerich. I recorded the Beatles.
Yeah.
You know, hello. And I was like, oh, I'm so sorry. Because I should have known, I suppose. But he was super sweet. And actually, in that moment, I thought, yeah, well, he lives here. And there's a lot of people living here. And I would like to just be a fish in the pond.
Yeah.
And that seemed like, I don't know, it was just a moment for me. Mm-hmm. You know, as a musician, I'd been here in 2000. And I thought, it's not a place I'd want to live. But I think LA is changing all the time.
Yeah.
And it's become a place full of creative people. And I just wanted to be a fish in the pond. You know,
yeah.
My work doesn't come from here. My work is global.
Right.
But it's fun to meet people and go out and do events. And, you know, last night or two nights ago, we were at AES parties. And
watching
fun.
Daniel Lanois. It was crazy.
Yeah. Yeah. Actually, yeah. Mm-hmm. Lanois played. And we, you know, so a long list of people that we saw out. And so that's, it's fun. If you're going to work all day, you might as well have some social events and nice weather.
Yeah. Yeah.
And that was my thinking.
Yeah.
You know.
That's awesome.
But I love Columbus and it's a great music city.
Yeah, absolutely. One of the kind of neat things is that this room is fairly similar to the one that you had in Columbus.
It is. It's fairly similar and yet completely different.
Right.
At the same time.
Right. True. Yeah.
Yeah, so you were there. So the physical geometry of where I sit and the speakers and the kind of speakers and the desk and the equipment hasn't changed. I mean, I threw this in, but
yeah,
some new amps this year. But what did change was, I don't know if you can see, but the room is actually pretty small. The physical room here is 12 by 15, but that's not really the room. Maybe we can shoot some B-roll or something, but the low end in this room, well, all the sound pressure in this room goes out, as you know, through the walls into the building. And the building's like four stories with open staircase.
Mm-hmm.
So even though it looks small, the effective, you know, low end physics of the room, it's a huge room.
Right.
But I'm just treating mids and highs mm-hmm. in this space and letting all the sound pressure go out.
Right.
So I'm getting the benefit of the two previous rooms I had, which have the same stuff more or less. Mm-hmm. But I'm getting a lot better sound. It's almost like setting up outside.
Right. You know?
It's actually better than that. But we've blocked it off, but there's fresh air and sunlight available every day.
Yeah. It's gonna say funny you should say that because you can just remove the back wall.
Yeah, I mean I don't know if we can show this, but
yeah, I think we can.
Can we show this? These are on casters back here. So this moves. And there's the world. And these doors open mm-hmm. and I can cut them open a little bit and vent some air in here. So, you know, 9-10 months out of the year, we'll move them back so that our lighting is proper.
Yeah. There we
keep
go.
Keep our lighting good. Okay, so 9 or 10 months out of the year, I can crack the window late at night and the hot air that's up on the fourth floor is trapped. Open the door to the roof, let it out, let this in, and literally fresh air streams through here.
Yeah.
Like 9 months out of the year. So that's amazing.
Yeah.
So sunlight, fresh air, I thought, okay, cool. This is a teeny thing, but it's not teeny because we're just going to let the sound pressure go up in the building. And mm-hmm. so this is all bass traps, and we've got, you know, some diffusion, a couple feet of R38 up there, and these are gapped off the wall. Mm-hmm. 6-inch reel trap, freestanding walls with a 6-inch gap, which is as good as you can do mm-hmm. for the bass. But really, we're just relying on not just all of this, which is great, and this stuff really works, but the low lows just to escape.
Yeah.
All the sub just goes out. And so I was able to, by moving around the insulation that's up in the roof, kind of, well, not roof, you know what I'm saying, that area up there, just kind of tune.
Yeah.
You know, you take a broomstick and punch it around a couple feet and you can change how the low end in the room, you know, responds.
Sure. Yeah.
That's what we did.
I have a funny story about that. The first time that I was here in this room, we were upstairs and you had Audio Slave playing down here, and I heard a compression on the bus that I had never heard before. I won't say overcompressed because that was a decision, but yeah, it was, to me, that was pretty incredible to hear that level of detail. On the second floor, I was hearing something that I had never heard listening to the record.
Right. So. Well, and that, you know, there were people here the other night. Jules was here from Gear Sluts, and a bunch of folks from Gear Sluts were here. Like, it ended up being, I thought it was going to be 10, and it ended up being 25. It was really nice. Mm. And that was one of the things we talked about. I think Jules had asked, he said, you know, do you ever just listen from upstairs? Mm-hmm. I said, absolutely. Because he said, as a producer, you know, he used to encourage, or maybe he said, force the band to go out in the hall mm-hmm. and listen in the hall and then give him the mix notes.
You right.
know, get out of the bells and whistles, get out of this, you know, sort of mindset, this sort of dogmatic fixed thing. Mm-hmm. Just go in the hall, walk down the hall and listen. And in Columbus, you were there. Mm-hmm. There's a long hallway there. Mm-hmm. You know, Freddie's space, mm-hmm. Mike Landel's room. So, you know, I could walk back and forth down the hall, go to the bathroom, what have you, mm-hmm. and you can listen in the hall with the door cracked.
Yeah.
Here it's the same thing. I might set up a record for a couple of hours. I go to print a first pass. I'll go upstairs, eat, maybe put on Sports Center with the sound off.
Yeah.
And listen to it while doing something else. Mm-hmm. And that keeps me fresh, which is a huge part of the day, is just to stay fresh.
Yeah.
You know, to
yeah.
always be fresh. You know, to not get in any of that, you know, studio cave coma that is the province of, you know, producing.
Right.
But for
right.
me is the death knell.
Yeah. So, and you fought that pretty heavily with every decision
exactly.
that you made here.
Yeah. Everything here is to keep it fresh. And yeah. I get up a lot, you know. I yeah. mean, I can sit in this chair for 4 hours, 5 hours, and I've done it before. Mm-hmm. But it's dumb. It makes me fat, and it isn't good for my brain, and it's just not a good idea. So
yeah.
I really try and get up every hour, walk, do something to come and stay fresh. But yeah
that's great.
Even on a busy day, there's always things to do to get up and come back in and
keep
that freshness. You know, I want to listen like you're going to listen when you haven't heard what I've done. Mm-hmm. I want to listen like the world's going to listen who's never heard it. And then I also want to listen like you're going to hear it in 5 years or mm-hmm. 10 years or 20 years. So that's the perspective I'm looking for, and to do that, yeah, there's a lot of tricks.
Yeah.
You know, that's why I go online. I've been on, you know, I go on Facebook, I go on Gear Sluts, I look at YouTube, I go to ESPN, I, I do things to not get stuck.
Right. Yeah.
In the perfectionism slash, you know, whatever.
Yeah.
I know the
yeah.
room, and the more I come in fresh, the better it goes for everyone.
Right. Yeah. I don't think I'll ever forget that experience of just hearing the timing on the compression. That was insane from the second floor. Just nuts.
Yeah. Well, that's good. Yeah. That's good news.
Absolutely. All right. Let's get nerdy. Let's talk about the chain.
Sure.
So one thing that I kind of wanted to try and do here, mastering to many is this black magic thing that happens. It's send me your file, and then I'll send you a file, and this thing's going to happen, and you're going to like it.
Yep.
You know, hopefully you're going to like it.
Yep.
So I think it'd be really beneficial to everybody if we kind of talk through the signal flow, maybe go through an order of the chain and
kind of chat. Yeah, well, I mean...
And I know, like...
Not to insult anyone's intelligence, but we could just start with the super basics of what is mastering. Mm-hmm. And for that, we would go back to, you know, actually making the master, which is the technical side of it, you know, a DDP master, or if I don't do vinyl, but if you cut vinyl, it's a lacquer master. So there's the technical side of mastering. But obviously, what people in my chair get paid for is the human side of it.
Mm-hmm.
What do the humans bring to the table? What do they bring in terms of the sound of their chain? What do they bring in terms of their decision-making, their perspective, their musical value to enhance what's there?
Yeah.
You know, any robot could do the nuts and bolts of it. You know, any robot could make it loud and balance frequencies and do some kind of LUFS measuring, RMS measuring, and that's not what it's about.
Yeah.
What it's really about for me, and I can't speak for anyone else, but for me, mastering is about connection between the artistic vision, the production, and the world. And what I mean by connection is much more than frequency balancing and make it loud and even, that kind of thing. Mm-hmm. Like, to me, that's a failure. You know, you might get a record that is EQ'd like this, but the style is like this.
Yeah.
You know, it should be reggae, and it sounds like, you know, a 90s rock record. So that's a gross version, but the decision making that's involved in playing with frequencies and playing with distortion and playing with transients and compression balances, those three things, which are to me the XYZ axis of the gig, frequency balancing, transient compression balancing, and distortion balancing. Playing with those things in a musical way that suits the style, suits the artist, suits the moment in time. Is it a demo? Is it a one song? Is it a five song? Is it the third record of a huge band? Is it like the Manson record? Is it a comeback record for an artist who has momentum but hasn't done anything for a while and needs something to kind of make things kick into gear?
Yeah.
All of that is what the mastering is to me. It's not the technical thing. It's how do we enhance what's been done in production to really connect and exceed expectations of the creative team.
Yeah.
So how do we do that? Nuts and bolts. Generally speaking, most people in my chair are going to have an EQ or two. They're going to have a compressor or two. They're going to have a limiter or two. The main tools there. To me, EQ is the big one of the three. I probably would say EQ, how you limit, and compression.
Yeah.
It's hard to put those in order. Forgive me, that was probably dumb. But I guess if I had to pick, that would be kind of the order. But yeah, it's EQ shaping, transient compression shaping, or not. I prefer not to.
Yeah.
And limiting. And I do my limiting by clipping mostly.
Yeah.
I have an L2, and people are like, "What are you doing with that?" And I have it set at 1.4. I like the mid-range pop of the L2. Up to around, you know, between 1 and 1.4, it has a little vocal area pop. Under that, it's pretty clean, and over that, it's completely horrible.
Yeah.
It's terrible. So
you just found its spot.
Yeah, it just stays at 1.4. Yeah.
And is this the first in the chain?
That's after the converter. So the chain would be, like, here we have a session I think we're going to look at, and here we have three songs I've never seen before. So this is a done session, this is a new session.
Okay.
So we're going to go out of here. I use the 15-year-old, maybe, MyTech 8X, the 8x192. I use that to feed the chain. And it's really 1, 2, 3. although I threw this in last year, the envelope. But this EQ is solid state. It's slightly forward because of the solid state nature, but we've cleaned up the ICs and we've made it a lot cleaner. Mm-hmm. We've taken out a bunch of caps. Mm-hmm. Then we go here, Class A discrete, Lisa Alpha serial number one, as I've said before. Mm-hmm. And I use this possibly for some mid-side EQing or possibly some mid-side compressing where I can do some things with the punch and the width that are not stepping on what's there, but just enhancing what's there.
Yeah.
And then the Fairman is always in boost mode and has discrete tubes per section to suit, you know, Telefunken boost here, Mullard high mid boost, RCA black plate low mid boost, and some clean Sylvanias for low shelf with an output tubes that are Bugle Boy EF86s from 1959 to 1964.
Yeah.
And that's always on, usually 4 dB or so.
Yeah.
So that drives right into the A to D, which you can't see, but it's the Pacific Microsonics converter.
Let's talk about the Fairman again for a second. So the you're also kind of known for your knowledge of tubes.
Guitar player wisdom comes in handy when it comes to tubing the Fairman.
Yeah, and you applied all of that from amps into
saying,
I like the sound of these things specifically for these bands.
Absolutely. Yeah, I mean, most people who are tube knowledgeable would probably agree with what I'm about to say, so this isn't necessarily an opinion, although everything's an opinion, I suppose. The mid-range of Mullards is particularly nice. So I'm going to boost, you know, 3K to 5, 6K with the Mullards. Telefunkens are nice on the top end. They have a particular kind of a thing. So I'm going to boost, you know, maybe a 14 to 16K. We're talking little teeny boosts. These are just little enhancements. The RCA black plates are able to boost low mids without getting muddy, which is tricky. And the Sylvanias are clean American tubes from usually the 60s, able to boost low frequencies without getting muddy.
Right.
You know, if you put the Mullards down here, it would be muddy. You know, if you put these Sylvanias in here, where the Mullards are for the high mid boost, it would be a little more boring. It would be a bit more anemic, a bit more sterile. So, yeah, there's a kind of a sweet spot for each tube, and I'm using it in those bands.
Right.
Yeah.
Cool. That's great. And then
it sounded good before. It came with like Russian tubes, you know.
Yeah.
And I used it, I think, for a couple of years, and then one day I thought, oh, let me look in there.
Yeah. You
know? Wonder what's in there. Oh gosh. Okay. And then.
Yeah.
A few weeks, I don't remember, month, I don't know how long it took. I found, you know, this, and now I just roll with this.
Awesome. Is that quite the process to change this out?
It's not that bad. You just have to make sure they're low noise, and, you know, you put them in, you test them, you run a signal, or just record no signal, listen to the noise.
Yeah.
You know, I buy them on eBay, or I'll buy them from a couple tube sellers that I know are decent, but you just have to stick them in and go.
Sure, yeah.
But not very often.
Yeah.
It's on all the time, and knock on wood, I haven't changed a tube. I mean, I can't remember when. I don't think in 3 years of being here I've changed a tube. So.
Wow.
That's pretty good.
That's good.
I've got some fans in there.
Yeah.
I had a tech move the caps. We put in new caps, and we put in high temperature caps, and we moved them to the other side of the circuit board. So they're physically away from all the tubes.
Right.
And I've got two fans blowing in the back and two fans right here that are always putting a little warm air on my knee.
Right.
So I'm moving a lot of air through it, and that might help.
Yeah.
You know, but it's not like it's a big nightmare.
Right.
You know, it doesn't happen often. Like I said, I think it's been 3 years.
Yeah. Do you find, well, I guess you don't have to, but do you keep stocks of tubes around just in case?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Yeah. It'd be pretty rough
in
the middle of a session.
Every so often I'll panic and think, do I have enough of those? And I'll go on eBay and I'll buy, and then I'll look in my drawer like, oh yeah, you got like six of those. So yeah, no, I have spares of everything.
Yeah, nice.
Yeah,
cool.
Yeah, yeah. And I actually have spares of you know, like I've got three L2s now, all with power supplies rebuilt. I've got another head that's out in the hall. You know, I could get whatever I need if I don't have it. But yeah. At this point, I have spares of things. I've got three Pacific Microsonics converters.
Yeah.
And they've all gone to the tech, and they're all ready to jump in a moment's notice. You know.
Yeah.
So yeah.
Great.
Spares.
So you're going into your Fairman, and then out from the Fairman to the Alesia?
No. So we'll go back. So from here to the D to A, out the D to A, one, two, three, mm-hmm. conversion. And then sometimes it'll go here. I added this envelope last year because people are really compressing the bejesus out of stuff in the last, whatever, 5 years. Mm-hmm. And I just didn't like a lot of different expander options that were out there. Mm-hmm. And I really like these guys. You know, Ruben's a genius, and you know, he if you don't know, he was at SPL. He did the original Transient Designer. Mm-hmm. The envelope is really not a mastering tool, and I don't use it very often because it has, you know, sort of slightly imperfect phase for mastering, but it's the trade-off is totally worth it for something that's been completely overdone.
Yeah,
I can get a little bit of life out of it. And I had him turn these half dB steps, or 1 dB, I forget, are they one? Yeah, they're half. I had him turn into quarter dB steps, so, you know, it's really very sensitive.
Yeah.
And I can just put a little life in it. So yeah, it used, for years, it's been 1-2-3 conversion. Now it's actually 1-2-3-4.
Gotcha.
And they're all hard bypassable.
Mm-hmm.
I would say these two EQs are always on anything I've ever done.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
Really great mixes don't need any compression, any mid-side, anything. And this is only for, you know, something that's really damaged.
Yeah.
So it's really mostly these two EQs with this guy coming in second, and that's like a rare case.
Right.
So yeah, and then we convert. A lot of headroom in there. It's Class A discrete. I don't know how hard I've hit it. It's probably 10 or 12 dB of headroom. I mean, that I'm using. It probably has more than that, but in terms of what it's able to sort of musically chop off and still sound really good. And then from there, the L2 for a 1.4. Mm-hmm. And then from there, my trick, which is now not a secret. It's not been a secret for a while, but I actually round off the square waved, you know, limited audio with just like a 1-1-0, or sometimes I'll turn up the tape, but that's digital in, digital out of that Crane Song head,
mm-hmm.
To just round off those square waves. And you know, we could do it. We could turn it on and off. Mm-hmm. Maybe people would hear it. I don't know, after all the conversion we're doing, if it would be obvious, but it just gives a little bit more of that sort of tubey depth.
Yeah.
You know, it's not a huge thing, but it's nicer.
Yeah.
You know, the difference between this and this is one of those, you know, icing on the cake things that's as subtle as a cable tone or something. It's pretty subtle.
Sure.
Pretty subtle.
Yeah. Well, cool. Let's quickly talk monitoring.
Sure.
Yeah. So the room, obviously, we've covered.
Yeah, the room is this real trap stuff. You know, from here back, we've got diffusion. We've got diffusion in the ceiling. First reflection points on the side walls, mm-hmm. are 4x4 foot dead zones. Those are high frequency grabbers. Everything else, mm-hmm. has a membrane, so you've got a lot of bass trapping. Yeah. These 6 2x2s on the ceiling are also high frequency grabbers.
Mm-hmm.
So the first reflections to the ceiling and the first reflections to the side walls are getting killed.
Yeah.
And then there's diffusion up there, which I had to play with to kind of get at the right formula. Mm-hmm. You know, the main thing I'll say for people at home, and forgive me if anyone's offended because this is obvious, but the main thing is low end. You know, trapping bass is the main problem that most people have and don't really deal with. And secondarily, the high frequency first reflection point killing is really nice for imaging.
Mm-hmm.
This diffusion thing is not really most people's concern. It really is like way down the list.
Yeah.
You've got to get the low end right. Then you want to get the imaging right. And if you do that, okay, you can move on to diffusion.
Right.
But it looks so sexy and fancy that like you want to do it.
Yeah.
Most people want to do it before they really need to do it. I mean, this is the first room that I've done, you know, this much on the ceiling. I always had some sidewall, but the main thing is bass trapping. And then first reflections.
Yeah.
So having said that, monitoring, as I was saying the other night when Jules and all the guests were here for the Gear Sluts thing, Thomas Barefoot, a dear friend, sweet guy, he was making speakers out of his bedroom, I think,
mm-hmm.
I don't know, 10, 15 years ago. And so I bought this like sort of handmade MM12, which was a front-firing 12 with the two now famous sort of barefoot mids and the tweeter that he was using. And on the back, he'd strapped a Bryson 4B SST, which was being split actively, half to the sub, half to the mid-tweeter, and then there was a passive crossover for the mid-tweeter. Mm-hmm. He made these for me, and like seven or eight people, I mean, he would know, but maybe it was 10, but I used those for like 4 years. And that went really well. And the company was still really unknown at the time. And I was sort of this much less known person who didn't have the credits I have now. And people said, you know, who's this guy talking about this speaker? And I'm like, no, this is really, he's kind of onto something here. This is going to be a thing. And, you know, Thomas and I kind of parted ways at the conceptual, I mean, we're still friends, but at the conceptual place of a couple things. One is he doesn't hear or believe in cable tone. Two, his drivers are not very dynamic, and I became very interested in dynamic drivers, mm-hmm. things which would move a lot and move quickly, even at low volumes. And then thirdly, just the tweeter and the way the whole mid and high end just got to me. And so I set out looking for a tweeter because, you know, from a fatigue standpoint and from cohesion, the tweeter crossover mid-range cohesion, like that, those two things are really important, fatigue and cohesion between the tweeter and mid-range. Now, obviously, mid to the sub tweeter, cohesion, also very important. But my mindset at the time was, I just can't do this design anymore. So these speakers interested me because the tweeter. Mm-hmm. I looked at the tweeter and intuitively, I'd never seen one before, but I said, that makes sense to me.
Yeah.
It's got a titanium center mm-hmm. and a cloth surround. So the low end of the frequencies coming out of the tweeter is you know, being distorted / produced, if you will, mm-hmm. by the cloth. And that made sense to me.
Yeah.
Metal tweeters of any style have never made sense to me. They all sound wrong to me. And it's kind of like, you know, like when Pro Tools would say, our summing is fine, summing is good. And people were making summing boxes and still do. Mm-hmm. And then the new Pro Tools, they would say, with new summing.
Right.
Right? So metal tweeters, kind of the same game. You know, whether it be Wilson or Focal, or I don't want to name all the people, but you can find metal tweeters in the world, mm-hmm. and they always come out with a new one every so often, you know. Mm-hmm. And they don't work for me. So I like the concept, though. I like a lightweight, quick, thin thing. That's yeah. part of my dynamic driver principle. I like that. Mm-hmm. So I thought, okay, well, maybe these could do that. They could be thin, quick, lightweight, but then the low end of what's coming out would be cloth. Mm-hmm. So that was how it started. I just liked the tweeter. And then I found out more about the company. Joachim Gerhardt, who had designed for Audiophysic, who had a company taken away from him because he's so brilliant that he needs to be medicated, and they were uncomfortable with that, and he was asked to sign away a company. And mm-hmm. so he'd had kind of a sad story, and he ended up with his good friend, who's now my good friend, and a fantastic hi-fi world guy named Alan Perkins. And Alan is up in Berkeley with a small company that makes turntables mostly. They make the spiral groove turntables, mm-hmm. which don't look like much. They're sort of like your normal, you know, it's not like spinning brass and 4 foot tall and dancing fairies. Right. It just looks like sort of a silver and black normal turntable.
Yeah.
But the technology is amazing. And they're 20 grand, they're 30 grand. And it's not just that they're expensive, because there's a lot more expensive. But the Grammy Museum called Alan, for example, one credibility example. They called him when the Beatles mono remasters came in and they wanted to listen. And he drove a turntable down and he set it up. And his mind is sharp. I was actually told the other day, I haven't verified this, but I was told the other day that he actually redid the math on tone arms so that the tracking of a tone arm is done now in a more even way. And like the math hadn't been touched in, I don't know, decades or something. So mm-hmm. Alan's company, Spiral Groove, has some sort of sub companies, and they make speakers for with Joachim's designs. Okay. So they have a bunch, and I was sort of drawn to this three-way tower thing. And he makes these drivers also. They're sold off the shelf, but they're designed by the speaker designer, Joachim Gerhardt. And it's the Allegra is the model.
Uh-huh. It's the spiral groove Allegras.
Well, yeah, it's a little, the branding is weird. These are the Sonics Allegra. This is the old, the cabinets are birch ply, mm-hmm. made in China. Now today, they make them out of bamboo ply, and they're all made in the USA. Mm-hmm. They're hand finished, hand built, they're CNC cut, blah, blah, blah. And they're a lot more money, but it's the same basic design. I mean, they've upgraded some things, but yeah, these technically are the Sonics by Joachim Gerhardt Allegra. And I've got a second pair upstairs. Mm-hmm. As a spare, and which allows me to listen to the same system.
You know, right.
The amps that I have here, which are the newer carry amps, mm-hmm. the 211 FE. The last generation that I had was the V12, and I have that upstairs.
Yeah.
So I'm listening to the same basic speaker amp thing, even if it's TV.
Yeah.
Or a soccer game or a football game or whatever. Yeah. So.
So you're establishing a consistent thing throughout your day.
Yeah, kind of yeah, and that just makes it that much easier to come and go.
Yeah,
you know, from the room, going back to the previous point of staying mm-hmm. fresh and you know, being able to be engaged yeah. in the right way. Mm-hmm. So yeah, they're really dynamic. They are rear ported, which I never really liked a rear port as much as I like these, mm-hmm. And. They have that tweeter, and you know, I've been on them now, I don't know, maybe 10 years. Wow. I can't remember. I don't see changing. I don't even want to try the new ones because I'm like, I don't think so. Yeah. I have upgraded amplifiers, but it's upgrades within the same family sound.
Yeah.
So as you will hear, you know, when we fire it up, of course people at home can't hear it, but mm-hmm. I'm not bothered by anything in here. It's not fatiguing. It's what I need. So I'm you never say never, but I'm hoping to roll with this for another 10 or 20. We'll see.
Yeah.
We'll see.
Do you have any tips for people that maybe they're monitor shopping and they're looking for something that suits them? You know, it might not be in a room as well treated, but what's something, you know, that personally drove you to these speakers and could help other people kind of inform that decision?
This is such a difficult topic. A few things about monitors. First, it's the most personal thing you ever buy.
Yeah.
Secondly, it's probably not going to last. Okay. Mm-hmm. Like these, I've gone 10 years and I might go 30. And I know, like David Bianco, who we, we mentioned the Lucinda Williams record. He, mm-hmm. he mixed.
Yeah.
Right. You know, he's using some Tannoys and he's had forever. And, you mm-hmm. know, Clear Mountain's probably still on his NS10s or whatever. You know, in some cases, you find your groove.
Yeah.
That's what you're trying to do.
Right.
But it's probably not going to happen anytime soon. Mm-hmm. And so what ends up happening is you've got the most personal choice that's got the shortest shelf life in many cases. Mm-hmm. And then people get so excited about it. Like it's the answer. Mm-hmm. Well, it's the answer for you
today.
Mm-hmm. But it's not any more of an answer than the other guy's answer for him. So.
Yeah.
The whole field of monitoring shopping it's kind of a mess. You know, there's a lot of buzz every year around something, mm-hmm. right? You know, there was like, I don't know how far back we want to go, but we could start with say, oh gosh, when was it? Like 92, maybe we could go back to 25 years and there was I'm trying to think when like the Genelec like 1031s were the thing, and then there was Mackie HR 824s were the thing, and the Event 2020s were in there, and all of these buzzworthy monitors exist in a certain price point.
Yeah,
that's the first thing you got to know. Mm-hmm. You're being conned because they know what you're going to spend, and they're just going to find something in that price point. Okay. Yeah. Now, when I say con, I don't mean that in a bad way, but you're being marketed to.
Yeah.
Okay. All speakers are a compromise. So, you know, when people buy the latest and greatest thing, because everyone says it's the latest and greatest thing, that right there is a failure decision.
Yeah.
What you have to do is get it in your room and work on it.
Yeah.
And in order to even know what you're looking for, you have to have a checklist of things about what you've got that bother you. There isn't a idealistic best speaker.
Right.
Just like there isn't a idealistic best mix. There isn't a perfect mix.
Right.
There isn't a perfect speaker. You're looking for the thing that works for you right now in your room based on where you are on the progression of learning the craft.
Yeah.
And I was as guilty of this as anyone. And so I'm not a hypocrite, but I'm a convert to just being patient and having it be a little bit more personal.
Yeah.
As opposed to, you know. I mean, if you go see a great movie and you're excited, it's the same thing, but it's really not, because a lot of people are gonna like the new movie.
Right.
The monitors are much trickier than that to really line up. So I would just say, you know, beware of enthusiasm, not to say always ignore it, but just get it in your room, work on it, and before you even do that, know what it is that's the shortcoming of what you have.
Right.
In a lot of cases, people's rooms are just the problem.
Right.
You know, again, going back to before, more bass strapping. Mm-hmm. In most people's rooms, you cannot physically put enough material in the room to get good low end.
Yeah, right.
So do every corner and you're still gonna have issues. So okay, so now the monitor is interactive with your room issues.
Right.
And that is interactive with your emotions and your mind. You know, what do you need to hear?
Right.
What kind of work do you do? Are you just mixing? Are you tracking? Do you need people to hear low end? Do they track in the room? How much power do you need? How much da-da-da? So, you know, all speakers have compromises built in, and you've just got to find the right compromise for you today.
Yeah, right.
That's the bottom line. Mm-hmm. What's the right compromise for me today? And the downside of current marketing, with the explosion of people doing it in the last 20 years, is that there are products now in so many price points that there's like a $300 price point.
Yeah.
And there's a $600 price point. And there's a $1,200. And so the marketing people who are making these products, they're aware of these price points. Mm-hmm. They're looking to build a thing to fit in these price points. So here's what ends up happening. Somebody says, well, I just, you know, I can't spend any more than $300 or $500. And then they have that thing. They do some work that's kind of mediocre because it's not working. It's not working with their room. They're upset with it. They don't like it. They're not jiving with their tool. So now they're going to spend another $500. So now they did $300. Now they're up to $800 in two things.
Yeah.
1 year went by. 2 years went by. Now they're up to $800. Now they're going to go another year, and they're like, you know what? The thing I really, really want to get is that. And imagine if you would have just taken care of your credit, had yourself a little credit card, mm-hmm. put it on the card, and paid it off over 1 year and kept it for three, mm-hmm. and your work would have gotten better right away.
Yeah.
And you would have had a consistent tool at a better quality.
Right. Yeah.
That's what I always did. I used to have a ton of debt, mm-hmm. because I needed a tool that did a thing and I couldn't pay for it. And I've found a way to manage getting what I needed. Mm-hmm. You know, and today I don't, you know, I don't have debt. I don't need tools.
Yeah.
But I went for the tool that worked.
Right.
And with monitoring, like with so many purchasing things today, there's so much of this sort of budget focus.
Yeah.
Without looking at the big picture. Mm-hmm. Like the big picture is you're going to buy a bunch of things over and over to get to the thing that you could have bought and saved a lot of time.
Right.
That's kind of dumb.
Right.
So you're not actually saving money. That's a waste of money.
Yeah.
But that's a different way of thinking. Most people's thinking, particularly after the 08 crash when things got so tight, you know, it's like, oh, well, I want to be good about my budget. And that's important. Don't be an idiot with debt. But, you know, if you're going to buy a $500 speaker and a $800 speaker and a $1,200 speaker, now you're up to 2,500, mm-hmm. you could have gotten the $2,500 speaker and been using it for 3 years.
Right.
And I think it takes $3,000 today to get a decent speaker. Mm-hmm. You know, I think the SCM20 is a decent speaker. The Amphion 15 or 18, I think those are decent speakers. Mm-hmm. There are a lot of decent speakers that are around $3,000.
Yeah.
I think that's the price point today, which is the starting price point to get something that's like workable.
Right, yeah.
Assuming you get the room.
I gotta
repeat that over and over for all the room acoustic folk out there. It's mm-hmm. hugely important.
Yeah.
So, bit of a long answer, but that's what I see. I see too much budget thinking. Right. And the same goes for mastering. Like, well, I have, I have $25. Like, well, no, you have one song, which is your calling card, and that song might change your life one way or another. Mm-hmm. What's that worth? You know. So, that's kind of my mode on money.
Yeah.
You go for quality. Because that's what makes your life better, and that's what makes your satisfaction go up, and your happiness of clients, and your better clients, and money comes with that. Yeah. Even in this economy, there's money there.
I like what you're. I like what you're saying too about kind of knowing what the problem is with the speakers that you have before jumping into something like that. I think that's really kind of an important thing, is to say, like, you know why you want those speakers or why you need that expensive speaker before, like, just thinking again, like you said, that the speaker is going to solve your problem.
Yeah, the same for gear. You know, people are like, "Oh, I heard this compressor is great." What does that mean?
Yeah,
it doesn't mean anything.
Right.
It means that you're a consumer. It means that you're an idiot. You're buying into consumerism. Mm. What we do with gear is about a palette. It's about a chain.
Yeah.
You know, my chain to me is one instrument. This is my thing.
Right.
Right. Mm-hmm. I might bypass this or that, but this is my tool.
Yeah.
And if you've got a production studio or a tracking studio, you know, everything's a chain. There is no gear on an island. There is no best anything on an island. So, yeah, you've got to know, what do I have and what do I want?
Yeah.
What's wrong with what I have?
Yeah.
There's way too much consumerism with it. You know, products are great and products are needed, but why?
Yeah. Yeah.
And how does it affect the palette, you know, of options? Like, if you're a tracking room, you might have all one preamp that you love, or you might have a couple. Mm-hmm. You might have this EQ. You might have that. It's your palette that suits what you're doing that's going to resonate with other people who are into what you're doing. And from that, you're going to build real relationships based on shared taste and shared vision.
Yeah.
You know? Mm-hmm. It's not, I'm going to buy that, and I'm going to buy that, and everything's going to be great. Like, that just makes no sense.
Yeah.
It doesn't work.
Yeah.
Or you know, sometimes I'm not going to buy anything is the best thing, but there are upgrades to be had with equipment. There's no doubt. I mean, I'm a big gear person.
Yeah. It's fun.
But and it's important.
Yeah.
But the skills of the engineer are always more important, and the main skill is what we're talking about, which is know where you are. Know what you're trying to accomplish, and know what's in the way of you accomplishing it, and then fix that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I think, you know, to kind of drive that point home, let's stop talking about the various little pieces of it.
Great.
And do some stuff, make some music.
Yeah. So, what we talked about was we've got two artists here. One is the artist that you brought.
Mm-hmm.
Do we know, should we pimp this artist out? Who is this person?
Let's see. Let me go. If maybe one thing that would be cool is if you want to talk about Sadie a little bit for a second.
Sequoia,
I'm sorry.
Yeah.
I apologize.
No, you're fine.
Yeah, if you want to maybe just talk about that, and I'm going to go find Mr. Lindell and get some answers.
Okay.
All right.
Well, so I work in Sequoia. A lot of people in my chair like Sequoia. Doesn't make it the best, but what we're looking at here is mixes 1, 2, 3 of this female artist that we're going to find out who she is, that I haven't listened to yet. And then what we're looking at here is mixes 1 through 13 of an artist that I called today, and they agreed to share Hamish Anderson. Hamish is living here in Los Angeles, but he's from Australia. He's a songwriter. He's a singer. He's a fine guitar player. And so we've got mixes here and the masters that are already on their way to being released in a couple of weeks down here. Yeah, we take solo off and these light up. So this is something I've done before. And mixed by Jim Scott at Player Studio here in LA. And this artist is...
Allison Stoner.
Allison Stoner.
And, these tracks were mixed by Ben Lindell.
Okay.
And they were produced by East Midwest Music Group.
Okay. There we go. So what should we do?
I'd say it's totally up to you at this point. Let's, you know, a lot of your thing is how you're feeling, you're reacting, you know, very much to how you are in the
okay.
moment.
Okay, so well, let's do this. Up. Let's start with Hamish, mm-hmm. and we can do a quick kind of pre and post. Oh, I should note that on this record, I've got one or two plugins going on mm-hmm. on the way out to the chain. So I've got the built-in Sequoia linear phase EQ, which mm-hmm. I like a lot, and occasionally there might be de-esser. There's like a little decrackler thing. Mm-hmm. So, but that's all I ever use. It's like one, maybe two, and then that's going out. And once it comes back in, I don't play with gain. I don't add a limiter later. If they say I want this thing louder or I don't want it as loud, I'm going to redo every time. Mm-hmm. Because the harmonic content created by my work is, you know, not happy with me moving into, I think it's 80-bit, 60 or 80-bit world. So mm-hmm. so these things, once they get printed, they're right. And if they're not right, I just do it again.
Hmm. Interesting.
So we'll just say that up front.
So there are no recall sheets for you?
Well, there's recall here and here, uh-huh. but I'm saying that I wouldn't go into the printed master and mess with that.
Oh, gotcha.
I would okay, just go yeah. back and start over.
Sure. Okay.
It takes a little more time, but it's important to me to keep the sort of signature of the work. Mm-hmm. So let's just have a listen here. This is Trouble. We're gonna start. This is the mix. Basically, what, just show you, I'll turn the volume down, try not to cheat, because louder always seems better. If you don't know, you should. Here's what became the mastered product, coming out in a couple weeks. Is to switch between the two. And so I'll do that, just I'll do the gain adjustment kind of on the fly. Trouble, feel it closing in. Trouble, a feeling now and everything. It's actually 10 dB mm-hmm. hotter.
Yeah.
So, you know, part of the trick in mastering is to make the thing loud and not sound like it's gone to hell. Mm-hmm. But that's, again, that's, I mean, any robot could do that. Mm-hmm. There's, but you, hopefully you can hear kind of the before and after there.
Yeah.
And then if we, let's see if we can recall this.
One little fun techie thing for streaming world. We like to cut playback for comments so that people can focus on, you know, either you speaking or the music going. So
don't talk over it.
Yep. Yeah, and then we don't have to leave your mic open while you're playing stuff too.
Oh, okay, good point. All right, so here, well, let's just do a real quick, I'll shut up, you can kill the mic. I'll just do a real quick. These are good mixes. Jim's really good. I'm just kind of, you know, I like low end. Jim likes low end. Hamish likes low end. There's a little, I'm moving it around, smoothing some things out. Mm-hmm. I wouldn't say it's thinner, although it may come across that way. I'm just trying to keep it beefy and organic, but satisfy the technical criteria. Yeah, so there's that. And then if we look at her stuff, we could do kind of a pretend three-song EP mastering, right? So mm-hmm. I get the tracks, I bring them in, I put them in alphabetically. I don't know what sequence it is, but let's pretend this is the sequence. Mm-hmm. Sequence is really important to me. I need to have a sequence before I begin.
Yeah.
So we'll pretend this was the sequence that they said. Sequence is important. Like, it, you know, if I start with a sequence and the artist changes it, that's fine. That's cool. That's great. A lot of times you need to hear, you know, the mastering, you need to hear the whole coming together. And then you realize, oh, okay, well, that song that I had issues with for tracking or mixing or writing reasons actually is pretty cool and should be over here.
Yeah.
Or that one that I thought was cool actually should be here. So sometimes, you know, really, really good producer minds, people come in and they've got killer sequences. But sometimes even really good producer minds are learning things as they go. So, you know, you want to always have that mindset of being on a plan, but being flexible with the plan.
Sure.
So for me, on a plan begins with, give me a sequence. Let's commit to that for what I do. I'm going to do that. And then if you change the sequence, I'm going to probably change what I did. Mm-hmm. Sometimes not, but the flow between the songs and how psychologically you as a listener interpret that is very important to me.
Yeah.
Because part of what I'm doing is overcoming your negative bias.
Right.
You know, my theory is that people love music and people don't want to listen to music at the same time. What I mean by that is they love music, it means the world to them, it makes their life awesome, they're always looking for something cool. But they also think they know everything and they think they've heard it before. And so all that kind of negative bias that makes someone say, oh yeah, no, I don't like that. Part of what I'm doing here is countering that. And that has to do with not just track one, but how track one flows to track two. Not just the single on the radio being right for that moment in the artist's career. You know, maybe it needs to be more produced sounding and maybe it needs to sound a little more raw. You know, that's what a single might do for an artist. Mm-hmm. But in terms of, you know, you listen to 3, 5, or 12 of them, there's an expectations flow.
Yeah.
People hear one, they say, oh, I know what this is. And then and they hear the second one, they're like, oh, I guess I didn't. And that's cool too. And then they hear the third one, they're like, oh, I didn't expect that. And then by the end of the fifth one, they're like, oh, I really, you know, so glad I bought this. This is like a real record. This isn't like a single and a bunch of throwaways, you know?
Yeah.
So that flow is important. So we'll pretend.
Specifically, what are a few things that you're doing to kind of guide that journey? You know,
that's tougher to answer.
Yeah, yeah.
That's harder to answer. That's
And maybe we'll see it as you do it.
Well, kind of. I mean, I don't know. In this case, I don't know the artist so much. So, it just depends on the situation. In this case, there's going to be less of that than normal. But we could actually be an interesting game. We could do it this way, and then if you come to me and say, "Oh, actually, we want that one to be track one," then I could look at it and say how I might do it differently.
Okay.
That we could do.
Okay.
Yeah. Because that's first impression.
Yeah.
You know, people make up their mind a lot of times in 3 seconds, mm-hmm. in 5 seconds. How does it feel? How does it hit me?
Yeah.
When I did Lucinda's record and she was listening to my stuff, you know, another guy in the band talked to me later. He said, you know, she just listened like 3 seconds for each song, you know.
Yeah.
She's very emotional. And he didn't mean to be sexist about it, but I said, well, that's actually the goal. If you listen for 3 seconds times three and you say, that's the guy.
Yeah.
That's what I'm going for. Yeah. I'm going for that sort of immediate engagement with the music.
Yeah.
So yeah. So let's pretend this is the sequence, and then we'll say, oh no, let's start with a different one. So that'll be good.
I am not here to play nice. I'll live with a good review.
Let's kind of do it by feel. Gap there. Keep these gaps around a little under 200. So as I do this, I'm listening to the style, I'm listening to the differences between the songs, I'm listening to relative vocal levels, I'm listening to relative low end levels, I'm looking at the width, I'm analyzing it as I just quickly kind of pop through these. And then we're going to do more of that. So now we'll just kind of do some level checking and some analyzing of, again, you know, vocal levels, overall balance, thinking about compression, just analyzing what's here, stylistically, technically, everything. Mm-hmm. Just did kind of a quick leveling out, but without any EQing done, so yeah. It's going to shift a little once we get in the frequencies. So it's honestly tricky to hear with all these lights in here.
Yeah.
It's very bright.
That's how you work, right?
It's very, yeah. Yeah, I work with, you know, 1,000 watts of lighting. So I feel a little off my game, but I'm going to do what I can do here. So let's see what we got. I'm just going to do some little linear phase kind of quickies, and then once I feel good about these just with a little digital EQ, then move over to the board, and in this case I'm just going to do one setting for all three.
Okay.
Because we don't have all night. So you'll notice I'm turned here. I'm doing one ear. That's on purpose. A lot of reasons. One, I don't want screens here. Mm-hmm. I don't want to be doing this. I don't want any screens. Secondly, the one ear is kind of like listening in mono. My left ear, for me, has always been my better ear, I guess you will say. Mm-hmm. When I was in bands, I would always be on the like this side of the stage, and I'd always go left ear. I think technically I've had it measured, and it's my worst ear on paper.
Those two things seem like they would correlate.
It's
the band over there.
Right, exactly. Yeah, I killed it. Well, actually, no, that started when I was a kid. My first concert was AC/DC with Bon Scott, and I was like 11, and I was on this side with these giant stacks, mm-hmm. and my ear rang for 3 days, and I think I lost like a dB.
Yeah.
So technically, you know, that doesn't matter. Your brain is what matters, right? So mm-hmm. this is my worst ear. It's down a dB. Its frequency is not as good as this one, but this is the one I work with in terms of getting this kind of setup.
Yeah.
Like hitting the mono button and mm-hmm. listening in mono.
Yeah.
So, you know, life is not technical. It's ultimately what happens between the ears.
Yeah. I think it's kind of important to kind of say something about this too, because I think people really feel a sense of fear about their ears a lot with that, and just constant concern that, you know, oh, I don't think I can mix because I had this thing happen, blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
I've heard that a lot from people.
Yeah, well, I mean, it's reasonable to be cautious.
Sure.
You know, I'm a big fan of caution, but not fear.
Yeah.
You know, anybody can do any work if their brain can do the work. Mm-hmm. I mean, the guys in my industry who are over 70 are still doing good work. Right. I'm sure if we measured their hearing, it would be horrible. It doesn't matter.
Right.
Because it's you know, you compensate the whole time. You're always compensating. So mm-hmm. frame of reference is where you get the confidence. Frame of reference is knowing your room. It's knowing some, like a dozen tracks that you always have around that describe, as I call it, describe the fence.
Yeah.
You know, not just good mixes that you want to copy. No, no. You want like the bright one, the dark one, the vocal forward, the slightly buried vocal that's still cool, mm-hmm. the mid-rangey hip-hop thing, the big low-end R&B thing. Like, you want to have descriptors of the fence in refs mm-hmm. before you learn a room and before you have monitors that you really know. So there's stages to confidence, which begin always with frame of reference.
Yeah.
And I have those still. I mean, I bet if I pull this session up. Yeah, see, here you go. Mm. So for this session, I mean, at this point, a lot of my refs are my own work, but some of it is other work. So when I went to do the Hamish record, I might have just jumped in and done it. Or I might have said, oh, you know, last night I had a beer at a show, or I had a lot of sugar for breakfast, or I'm feeling tired. Let me just check where I am.
Yeah.
And so I pull up my refs.
Right.
And it only takes a few seconds. So here's, mm-hmm. you know, let's see what I've got here. I've had these for like 15 years, most of them. Let's see what some of my refs are. Big low end, big scoop, Pro Tools production. All the streets are crap. Ape done by Lenoir with what I consider to be a great sound, but a very sibilant vocal. Mm-hmm. So that's kind of my two sibilant mm-hmm. vocal reference within a great sound. Mm-hmm. What else do I have here? Back. That. Let's see.
cloud, the flyest thing.
Of what not to do.
This is for the cheese, and this is.
That's just one set of things that stylistically have nothing to do with anything, sure. But they all have sort of technical edge-defining properties.
Yeah.
So yeah. I haven't listened to them in a long time. But normally I would just like hit Norah Jones or something if I was lost. But
yeah.
Having those refs, not my refs, but your refs, that describe the edges of the technical fence to you mm-hmm. is very important to be able to play within the fence.
Yeah.
You know, and mastering wise, you know, at this point I would reference my own stuff because what I feel that I did for my own work was I've got records out there now that sort of move the fence a little bit.
Yeah.
They moved it in a way that where I wanted it to go where it wasn't going. So if we listen to this. Mixed.
The feet are stumbling, walk me down the street in the light.
Where a ref could come in handy. I didn't actually do this, but.
Won't you help me roll back home? The feet are stumbling, walk me down the street in the light.
You hear in this section some S's?
The feet are stumbling, walk me down the street in the light.
So there's a line that you draw there. How much S? A little S-ing is intimacy. Too much is, you know. And so my mm-hmm. ref for Emmy Lou, which again is a record I love, Wrecking Ball, I love Lenoir, you know, I might check that or maybe check a Coldplay thing because he's usually got a lot of S. And I would say, oh, okay, well, in the world, over decades, this defines what is an acceptable, but to me, a high degree of sibilance.
Yeah.
And then I'm going to choose how much for Chet to do, mm-hmm. you know, mm-hmm. too little and it's not going to jump and you're not going to get the spitty back of the throat, too much and it's going to be like eh.
Yeah.
And my mastering thing is not to, again, hit anyone too much over the head, but to be inviting. So there's a balance between the brightness, which is intimacy inducing mm-hmm. and gets you into the back of their spitty throat,
yeah,
gets
yeah.
that Telefunken 251 mm-hmm. curve, and too much, which becomes like, you know, what I call trying too hard. So, you know, that could be a place where you might check a ref or something. But basically, the refs are just there to kind of hit them at the start of the day.
Yeah.
Anyway, okay. I feel like I kind of went off there. Did I actually answer your question, or did what was your thought?
I have no idea.
I can't remember either. I'm sorry. It's hot in here. I started rambling. No, it's actually not that hot. It's just very bright.
Yeah. Question, or it may have been one I wanted to ask, but it was, I think you already touched it, but I kind of heard a lot of things as you were going through there. You had the reference for do not do this, you had sibilance, you had, I believe, low end.
Yep, big low end, like huge low end,
yeah.
in the track one from Homogenic.
Yeah,
like, yeah, what might define the fence for your own refs that mm-hmm. you would make, not mine, mine mm-hmm. are irrelevant. Yeah, would be, you know, what's a bright record that's acceptably bright and thin? What's a mid-rangey record that's acceptably mid-rangey and thin? What's a record that's darker and has low mids or low end that's big?
Yeah.
What's a vocal that's really out front that's okay for the style? What's a, you know, two ice cream cone vocal, like a Celine Dion vocal or something that's like super pop? what's a buried vocal that might be cool for a punk thing, or might be cool for an, maybe a rap within the context of a brighter R&B lead vocal. You know, just having refs from the world that have been done over time that define the edges.
Yeah.
Otherwise, it's just a subjective feeling in the room, like it feels good to me. And most people today aren't really trained in thinking about how they're working. And so you're in a funky room with a funky pair of speakers, not really thinking about it, and you're just doing what feels good and sounds good at the time.
Right.
Now, what feels good and sounds good at the time is very, very important. Without that, the sort of focused, emotional clarity of the mix would never come across, right? We have to be engaged. Mm-hmm. But you also have to have the context, the frame of reference. And so, again, the way I describe it is some refs for the fence.
Yeah.
And you know, back in the day, I used to take refs, those or others, out to listen. You know, if I went to AES, even though it's a horrible room, I'd say, hey, can we stick my CD or now files in? Yeah. I just went yesterday. I took 6 30-second snippets, mm-hmm. some stuff that I had done, some stuff that I hadn't, and listened to a pair of monitors that will go unmentioned because they were completely horrible mm-hmm. and ridiculously expensive, and I was just like, what? But I took them with me. And even in the trade show room with the noise and all that, I know what they are.
Right.
Because I know what they are in my room. I know what they are more or less in reality, so I can take them into other rooms, other situations. So yeah, that's very important. And that gives you the confidence to do things like, what compressor do I like or not like? And you know, how do I be aggressive and musical in this mix, not fearful and conservative and timid about it?
Yeah.
You know, there's no way to be confident if you don't have a frame of reference.
Right.
That's what we were talking about.
Great.
Right, yeah. And you were talking about buying speakers. And then I mentioned buying anything, right? So that's a good topic, because otherwise you're just sort of in this emotional / conceptual blown in the wind thing.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, you can have certain concepts that are just wrong, mm-hmm. or you can have feelings that are not in line because they're not within that frame of reference.
Right.
The two have to come together. Your mind and your heart have to work in concert to create a great thing, and you've got to have that frame of reference to do it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's fantastic. I want to take 2 seconds, actually. We have a Facebook group called Pure Mixers, and in that group, we started a post where we're building a Spotify playlist for references.
Okay.
And what we're asking people to do is, you know, say, what do you use for references, and explain why, the same way that you're doing it now. I listen for the S in this one. And like you're saying, it's very personal. They have to find their own thing that works, but like that kind of guiding thing, like, this is what I specifically use this reference for.
Right.
It's pretty useful. So
totally.
It'd be great to get you on that at some point.
Sure.
That'd be really cool.
Sure, yeah. I mean, I could throw up my old refs or my new refs or, you know, whatever. I'd be glad to throw them up there.
Yeah, great.
Yeah, I mean, it's again, it's one of those things. It's nice to see what other people are doing, and then you have to do it for yourself.
Right. Yeah.
You know, you can't just buy the monitor or the EQ or the refs list of someone else.
Exactly.
It has to work in a context that's an ongoing process of learning and then applying. Mm-hmm. You know, for yourself.
Great.
Okay, so back to this. We did some quick leveling just by grabbing the little handles here. Did some tips and tails, had some quick analysis of it, and then I did some digital EQing. And so let's go, and now I'm going to just throw it all through the chain. Again, we're just going to do one setting for these three, and let's see what we do here. Just a little mid-shift. hue to eliminate some of the 3K in that one. So just real quickly, that's those three. And what we can do now is, thanks to the 1 dB, although I wish it was half dB, steps built into the Avocet, we can gain up the mix and just go back and forth real quick. So let's see if I can get the gains kind of close here. Just copy these. Let's copy these over. And well, that's strange. My EQs have disappeared. What the heck just happened? It is a live on camera, totally strange gremlin. Huh. Okay, let's quickly go to the backup. Let's try this guy. Yep.
So what are you doing right now?
I just went and grabbed the backup session. Somehow the three digital EQs that I just tweaked in there went away. So now I'm just going to take a quick peek at it and see if they are the way I left them and how long ago. Yeah, they're not quite the same. All right, so we're going to do it again. So I'm just going to do a quick tweak of these three digital EQs going through this one chain setting, which I did when you weren't paying attention. I could talk about it. Let me do this first, because my mind remembers pretty much what I just did. So let me just get us back where we were. No idea what just happened there, but shit happens. Not quite as cool as it was, but it's okay. The first song maybe not as cool, the other ones are okay. Okay, so now we are listening there post-chain, so we're going to...
So I have to ask,
yeah.
What is it about the first song that's happening right now that's not as cool?
Well, I remember what I did. I think it was actually someone could probably go back and rewind it, and someone probably will. No, it wasn't that. It's just musically not quite where I wanted it. Let me think. What was it I did? This is a good moment, actually. You can't really go back.
Yeah.
You have to go forward.
Right,
so.
Right.
You have to really let it go, and I'm struggling with trying to remember and letting it go. My body, and then where'd the vocal go? Let's go back here. I think it's just where I'm gonna put this. I'm gonna put this little bump. Let's put this little bump. Is still bugging me, so let's go with let's make this a little sharper, cut it a little more. At this point, it's probably obvious, but stating the obvious, I'm listening to the loudest section of each one because I've set up the rest. Unless I'm going to go in and do section by section digital EQing, which sometimes I would do, but not in this case. I mean, I would only do it if there was a client request for a section, which hopefully wouldn't happen because they've already worked that out.
Yeah.
Or I might do it if I'm in a relationship with the artist where they've given me a lot of freedom and they say, oh, you know, do whatever you want to do. And I might do that. Or I might do it and just not tell you. And see if you notice, because it just seems right to me. So in this case, we're not doing that. So we're just listening to the loudest bit. You can see, actually, the production of this one at relative levels, you can see this one is pancaked more than these two.
Sure.
So part of the issue in this one is I'm trying to get the dynamic sort of feeling by playing with frequencies to get it to kind of match. And it's never really going to, because it got slammed a little more. But that's okay, you know. But that would make it an interesting one to put, you know, here or here. If we have time, we could do that. I don't know if you still want to do that, but it's real good to me. Again, under these lights, I can't really say for sure. It's really bright, and it's, you know, for me, the light being dim allows the ears to work better. So I don't want it to be too dark, but I like it to be dim, because you only have so much sensory information you can process. It's just straight, you know, it's a straight quantity versus quality thing. So, but having said that, given the caveat, this sounds pretty good. Thick, and I want to hear that vocal in the mids a little more. I'm going to move this down. I'm going to make this a little bit wider. That was the wrong one. Of where over compressing or limiting kind of leaves you. You know, you've got these two that are really playing very well together. They're plenty loud, they're dynamic, they're energetic. And then this cat is pulling up the rear. And in this case, it's our first song, actually a good challenge in this pretend order that we put in. So let's play with some frequencies to cheat a little bit on the dynamics. Okay, and then if that doesn't do it, then we can always actually have this on. I'm just going to crank this up a little bit. So we can do that. So if at this point I would print all three and I would just put a little more sparkly transient life into that first one,
mm-hmm.
and send it out and see what kind of comments and go from there.
Yeah, yeah, great. So we've got a couple pieces that haven't been used, right?
Oh, no, they're on. I just did it. I did it when you weren't looking.
Okay.
So the settings here aren't going to make sense because this isn't linear.
Mm-hmm.
So I've got a lot of boost going on. Like there's a 150 shelf here. There's a 47 narrow bump here. Mm-hmm. There's also a 80 hertz shelf here. That sounds like a ton of boost. This is a 3/4 dB boost. This is 2/3. This is 2/3.
Mm-hmm.
But this thing is actually, it's not linear. It's on the thin side. So some of that has to be there to kind of make it balanced.
Yeah.
And then I'm high passing. And then this guy, I did some of the mid-side kind of EQing.
Mm-hmm.
And I compressed a little using the sidechain gain and kind of mm-hmm. grabbed the middle a little bit. So there's a little EQ thing here, 1.6 based around 300.
Mm-hmm.
I can show you what that sounds like if we shift it. We could just take it off. And then we could push it really hard. That's not clear. You can actually just mono this side. So this is off and it's just the sides. Too much. So yeah, that's not a mix thing though. That doesn't really help any with mixing.
Yeah.
That's a mastering engineer. That's just a subtle tweak to shape. You know, a lot of times in your mix room, your monitors are too wide or too narrow for the room. That's actually a good topic. I'd like to give people the sort of a couple ideas on how to set up the monitors in the room. When you listen back to really well done stuff, and you have to decide what that is, of course, once you get more comfortable with great records over time. But there should be a balance between center power
mm-hmm.
and the side spice, which is slightly favoring the center power. In other words, there should be more energy coming out of where the kick and the bass are
mm-hmm.
than there is on the sides. And so when you're setting up in your room, you want to play with the width so that, you know, the reaction between the speakers and your room gives you that sort of mid-side low frequency balance
mm-hmm.
so that you can then mix to that balance. If, for example, your monitors are too narrow in the room, then you're going to over pan to get the sense of width and excitement.
Yeah.
And so when I get it, I'm going to hear that the center is recessed.
Right.
Because you've over panned it.
Right.
If the opposite is the case and your monitors are technically speaking too wide in the room, then you're going to underpan
mm-hmm.
and it's going to sound mono. Now I may not know because maybe you want it to be mono, so that gets tricky because that's sure. an artistic decision.
Yeah.
But ideally you get it set up so that the width is right, meaning there's a little more low end than there is what's coming out here, and you get a nice solid shape. So part of what I do in this room is tweak that if needed. Now, a lot of people's work doesn't need it.
Yeah.
And this one just needs a little, which mm-hmm. is pretty common also. And then occasionally something is jacked. This is a good mix. It just needs a little. The mm-hmm. best of the best mixes, this would be off. I never mess with it. I mean, the best of the best mixes, this is off.
Yeah.
But again, we're talking a subtle thing. So these are good mixes, and they're getting kind of a standard kind of modest treatment.
Yeah, yeah.
To just shape that, to shape that V.
Yeah, there it is. That's the phrase I was looking for.
The shape of the V.
Shaping the V.
The shape of the V. The shape of the low end V. Yeah, the shape of the low end V. I've talked about before. It's something that it's important to me. Going back to the idea of overcoming expectations, when someone hears music that they say is too produced, what do they mean? Because of course everything's produced, right? Yeah. That's ridiculous. So too produced is the V shape of the low end is too narrow. It's too pop. Mm-hmm. For what they want from that artist. They want something that's more, you know, like here with below 500, below 200.
Yeah.
They want it to be meatier on the sides. Mm-hmm. The meatier the sides get, the less definition you have with the kick and bass and the low end.
Yeah.
Because the you know, what's panned out, let's say you've gone left, center, right. So what's hard panned out is now competing with what's center panned.
Mm-hmm.
So the shape of that V is a subconscious, immediate, two-second trigger on what this music is.
Right.
And if you're listening to someone with a certain expectation and they move too far from it, they might lose you.
Right.
Or the opposite can be the case. You know. So I play with that per song, per artist, per record. You know, it's all different every day. If it hasn't been played with by a really great mixer who knows how to play with it on their end.
Sure.
And if they do, it's pretty obvious to me, and I'm just like, okay, off, we're good.
Yeah.
We can deal with EQing, we can deal with limiting and the artifacts that happen with the interaction of those two things and just deal with that.
Yeah. Now, when I hear you say that and I'm thinking about what that actually looks like, you know, the V being, if I was looking down on the V, or you know, in this case, straight ahead at the V, right? So
straight
the sides are
V.
closer to me than the.
Well, I'm what I'm saying is, if we're just talking about panning, and we're talking about low end, cutting low end on the sides, it's a question of how much are we cutting?
Mm-hmm.
Are we just doing a little high pass for safety? Are we doing something really aggressive? Is it going all the way up to 500? You know, if I play, let's go back to the refs. If I could find, I think this is Destiny's Child, right? This is an old thing. Let's see if I can find it. I'm not Snoop. This is a very steep pop V. There's nothing with any kind of meat on the sides, right? Very obvious. Here we go. Punch and definition in here, and then out here it's and then vocals, because there's three of them, and so you've got some like left, center, right type. Technically great mix. It's really clear here. You've got little sizzly bits to keep it feeling wide, and then they come in and hit with the full body of the chorus.
Right.
Now, when you listen to that for 2 seconds, sounds like pop, like boom.
Yeah.
Right? So if you go to something else, has big low end, but a little more width. Or let's go to. The example where it starts with a real clear mono, then the guitars come in, they're very full. We still have kick and bass, but we don't have pop, we have rock. Why? Because of the shape of the V.
Mm-hmm.
You know it. Meaty side guitars versus the other two singers in Destiny's Child. So that, and there's a whole different curve there. Let's be clear. There's a whole different curve to those tunes.
Right.
Okay, it's a whole different thing. But that's a subconscious trigger that we all sort of take for granted, and that's part of what I'm playing with here to overcome expectations in the negative and get you to connect and say, oh, I really dig that.
Yeah.
That's really cool.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah. Does that answer it?
Absolutely.
Okay.
Yeah, that's great.
Okay.
So I'm thinking that we have two things that we could do.
Okay.
Here. We could try that sequencing thing.
Yeah, we could try it real quick.
Okay.
Just to think about it?
Yeah. Let's just spend like a couple minutes on it.
5 minutes.
Cool.
Okay. So we had, if we were printing it, I was going to jack some transient here and do something like this. Because that's how I am. I tweak. Like, usually before anything goes out, I've worked on it like 5 times.
Yeah.
You know? And so we've had a minute to come back to it. You know, this could have been me going to the bathroom or going up to get a sandwich, and now I'm back. So here we go. The style of this, maybe not the best example for this because they're all pretty, I would say they're interchangeable.
Sure. Yeah. Yeah.
So maybe not the best example. I'm not sure I would do anything that different, to be honest. This is one of those cases, but
yeah,
let's just do it for the sake of we said we would. And let me see once we actually commit to it, if it feels any different to me. So let's go back here. Because now, instead of the start of this 3-song EP or full-length record being, so that has a natural introduction to the artist. We have a little ticky ticky, we have a thing, we have a vocal, right? Mm-hmm. That's a natural introduction. This is the, you know, hit you over the head type introduction, but there's some mid-range here that I would play with. If this was the job of the day, I would make this low mid a little bit cleaner, probably for the whole song, but at least for this intro. And then I would go in here and do the little crossfade chop with the T shortcut, and I would drop this down so that it hits when the vocal comes in. Because we're all about setting up the vocal, and that was making me kind of lean away from this artist. So let's try this. Turns out to be a great example.
Yeah.
I want more vocal here. I want it to be a little brighter. I want this to be more exciting. So I like this little, I don't know, what is it, half dB, 3200s? No, it's a dB. Cool. Better introduction to her. You know, she's sort of like a suggestion, and then she sings.
Yeah.
I'm like, oh, who's the artist? That's cool. And then she comes in, and I'm like, all right. So there you go.
Have you ever gotten a record and disagreed with the sequence and talked to the artist about it?
It's not so much that I would disagree because it's not my call.
Yeah.
But if the sequence isn't a decent sequence, it makes it harder for me to do my job because they don't flow. So a lot of times when the sequence isn't good at first, artists will figure it out. And then when they change it, I will say, give me a day and let me just tweak everything.
Yeah.
And I'll redo it all because now it really speaks to who they are.
Right.
And it just flows for me.
Yeah.
And I can't mention any records, but some big records were like that where, and some records from up and coming artists where, you know, you can't be perfect. You know, it's a process.
Yeah.
It's a creative process. So you do your best. I do my best. You listen back to the M1 pass and you think, oh gosh, here's where we are now, da, 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 da. You move it around, boom, opens up. Comes back to me, boom, it opens up. It makes more sense. I go in, flows easier. The record informs me at that point, as opposed to me forcing myself on it to make it something. It's now telling me what it wants to be.
Right.
So a good sequence, you know, once it gets in that range where it informs me, then that's a good sequence. But I wouldn't argue about it. The only thing that I would ever argue about is if somebody was really insistent on something that seemed to me out of bounds. Examples are few and far between. I don't argue a lot, but
yeah.
if it's just pushing the level beyond, and I say, well, I just ask why.
Yeah.
Do you think it's going to sell better? I've got it in a nice loud range. It's plenty loud. I do this all the time. Mm-hmm. You know, what's the motivation? And if the answer is, well, we just think that might be cool. We want to try it. That's a great answer. That happened last week. Mm-hmm. Clients I know a long time in respect, like, yeah, it's cool. We just want to see it. And now they're living with it to see. You know, they wanted the distortion, basically.
Right.
They wanted it to just be even more slam based on a musical criteria, not based on like we're afraid no one will pay attention to us.
Sure.
Because that's a bad decision. But their decision was a good one. It was a creative decision.
Yeah.
Another argument, again, they're few and far between. One time I wrote a letter to a client who's pretty well known and mentioned that the one song that they were doing that they didn't want. They loved what I did, but the lead single for the record, they wanted to use the mix untouched. And my suggestion was that was a bad idea because it was, I don't want to say too much, I'll give it away, but it might alienate people based on their expectations of this artist. And that's actually what happened. So I never wrote back to say I was right. I just was sad because it was, to me, it was a missed opportunity where they could have connected better.
Yeah.
They made their choice and that's what happened, you know?
Sure.
So I tried and then I was like, hey, it's your record, you know?
Yeah.
Just, this is my professional opinion. I'm going to give it to you one time.
Yeah.
And after that, it's a service job.
Right.
You know, but it's okay to do that. It's okay to say to the client, you know, if it makes sense, if you can make a reasonable argument, you know, you don't have to be a slave to be a service provider.
Yeah.
Service is service.
Mm-hmm.
And so there's an element of service where there's respecting the dignity of each person. And if I say, you know, from my position and my experience, in my opinion, for your record, which is your choice, this is my opinion. And they say, yeah, I get that, but let's go with that. I'm like, okay, cool.
Yeah,
let's do it. Let's get it done. You're happy and I'll move on. You know, but that moment is an okay moment. And it's important for people to know that because it can go too far. Some people are unable to provide service with humility, and some people are unable to stand up for something that they can defend and have a conversation.
Yeah.
And the more of a conversation it is and the more respect there is between the people who are involved, the better the result. Mm-hmm. You know, it's not a right answer, but there's a right process, and the process is being respectful and communicative. It's like any relationship. Just communicate and be respectful, and this is going to work out.
Sure.
You know, so.
Yep.
But
well,
no,
great.
I would not argue sequence.
Yeah, yeah.
Not my job.
Cool. Yeah. Or suggest.
No.
Yeah.
No, I don't want to get into it. I mean, if someone asks me, maybe, but it's a different mindset. It's a producer mindset.
Mm-hmm.
So when I get to work, I'm thinking, okay, you like what you sent me.
Yeah.
You're happy, and I'm going to enhance what you like.
Right.
I'm not thinking like a producer. I'm thinking like a mastering engineer.
Yeah.
That I'm in my proper place. And if you say, hey, I need you to think like a producer, my first thing is, well, why aren't you thinking like a producer?
Right.
Or they say, what do you think about our song? Well, what do you think about your song?
Mm-hmm.
You know, this is not for me to say. This is for you. You know, you need to be confident. You need to have done everything you can to mix it. You need to have thought about the sequence before you send it, and then, of course, we can change it.
Yeah.
I encourage people to do their job because that's going to make the result better.
Right.
You know, it's a team effort. If everyone plays their role in a respectful and co-creative way, it's going to succeed.
Yeah.
You know, whatever success means, it's going to succeed. It's when the roles get wacky and people's egos get in and they can't communicate, and then less than ideal things happen.
Sure.
You know, so yeah, I tend to not go out of my role unless I'm asked, and even then I tend to not go out of it because I'm going to ask you to do it.
Yeah. Yeah.
But, you know, if it's a friend, you know, like the other day I did I plug the California Guitar Trio, my guitar craft friends who've toured and played and written for, I don't know if it's 20 or 25 years. Mm-hmm. And they asked me about the sequence, and they asked me to stick in some reverb, which I never do, ever.
Yeah.
And, you know, I did all that, you know. Got a Bricasti from the good folks at Bricasti. And, and I asked them, okay, well, if we're going to do that, give me left, center, right guitars, and let's do it. So, you know, but that's helping a friend.
Yeah.
That's one out of, you know, 16 years.
Sure.
Normally, it's just I try to stay in my role and encourage people to live their role to the fullest.
Yeah, yeah. And you've done a lot of talking about that in other videos and some videos on your site as well that people can find, right?
I did like around Christmas of last year, I did like these little minute and a half things. Yeah.
Yeah.
Some of the things we're talking about here and some other things. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. We just set up a camera and ran it for 2 hours and just cut it into, you know, 30 some little snippets. Yeah. It's on YouTube.
Yeah. I recommend people check that out because you talk a lot about, you know, you have a number of processes as you see the entire thing from start to finish, and you talk about positive compromise and
yes, from the moment of inspiration to arrangement to tracking to recording the tracking, which is an engineer step, to mixing to mastering, and I think there's a seventh step I've realized too, but I right now can't can't think of it, but you know. Each step being about, you know, rolling the rock downhill, expression I use for having a sort of a, you know, a positive compromise from one step to the next where you get more than you give up, and having it be not perfectionistic, but high standards and then you let it go.
Yeah.
High standards and then you move on. So that moving on and that momentum carries over in the music.
Right.
Because momentum is everything. Momentum in music, momentum in life, momentum in business. Momentum is everything. And so momentum in music production is created by, you know, sort of knowing when enough is enough and when to move on.
Yeah.
And knowing how to be co-creative and yet someone's the decision maker.
Right.
You know,
right.
Someone's the producer, someone's the this, someone's the that. So momentum is created by those two things, you know. Who's at the bow and how well is this boat moving?
Yeah.
And then you get it moving. And if you do all those steps with momentum and co-creativity and respect, you end up with what I call a surprise, which is, oh, this is actually better than we thought we could do.
Yeah.
Those are the great records, where it goes beyond what you could imagine. You know, a lot of people are caught up in, I'm going to do what I'm thinking I'm going to do. I'm going to control it fully, beginning to end.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, that's not it. You want to be open to doing something greater than you thought you could do. And you do that by taking each step.
Sure.
And kind of getting the momentum going from step to step. Yeah, so that's in the videos.
Yes. Yeah, yeah.
Good
that's
plug.
Great. I really enjoy
good plug
your
for the videos, Mark.
Yeah. No problem. You can slip me a check later.
Absolutely. Or a glass of water.
Even better.
Okay.
Okay, let's do some Q&A stuff.
Q&A, let's do it.
So we had some people write in with some questions.
Okay.
And we can, you know, we'll try to fit in a couple of these, so we'll keep them relatively short. But Thomas Brown, I think I'm saying that right. Sorry, Thomas, if I'm not. He's asking about some criteria for picking the best mastering engineer for him.
Okay. Well, first, Thomas, I would say, like in all things, trust your gut. Secondly, I would say, like in all things, do your homework.
Mm-hmm.
Who do you like? How do you know if you like them? You've got to listen to enough of their stuff to get a sense of what they do. I think if you listen to 10 or 12 of my records, you have a sense of what I do that goes beyond what I was asked to do or what I was given. I would say the same goes for listening to anybody. If you listen to a dozen records by somebody and you basically like all of them for different reasons, then you're liking that engineer and you're hearing how they worked with what they were given.
Yeah.
So that's a very good question. Yeah, trust your gut always, and you know, do your homework. You know, engineers have a sound. We don't intend to have a sound.
Mm-hmm.
We don't mean to have a sound, but we have a range of things that we do as a result of two things. One is the chain, And some people have a lot of chain options, so they're going to have maybe a more diverse palette of sounds. Yeah. But then there's who they are. Those things come into play. So it's totally a service job, but you can't take the engineer out of the equation.
Yeah.
And so if you hear enough from people, you get a sense.
Yeah.
You get a sense of what they do, but you can't get it from one or two.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, it took me years to learn what Bob Ludwig does, and, sure. and now I know. It took me years to learn what Ted Jensen does, and now I know.
Yeah.
And I mean, I know what the engineers do because I guess I listen for overview. I guess that's the third thing. That's very important. Okay. Third thing, Thomas, listening for overview. What is overview? Overview is the world that we're living in here. It's the harmonic frequency, transient compression suit of clothes that ends up on these tracks. So overview is the mastering engineer's world, you know. It's how things come across. We didn't write it, we didn't order it, mm-hmm. we didn't produce it, but it's how it comes across. How are we enhancing the vision that was given to us?
Yeah.
How are we enhancing that? So you have to listen to that part. You know, we can listen to music a thousand ways. You can listen to the guitar player. You can listen to the song structure. You can listen to the mastering. It's like one of the ways that you can listen to a record.
Yeah.
And it's tricky to notice at first, but with practice you hear, okay, well, that's basically what that person sounds like.
Sure.
That's basically what that person sounds like.
Mm-hmm. Cool. Okay.
Hopefully helpful.
Yeah. Next question is from Gordon Goodluck. He is the
Gordon, I know.
Yeah, he's the community manager over at the Pensado Students Facebook group.
Absolutely.
Have to give a shout out to those guys. I know a lot of you guys are here watching right now. I saw Bill Kamak and MT Champion running around in the chat there. So thanks for coming by, guys. Appreciate it. So Gordon is asking if you have a specific brand or type of cable for your analog chain.
I do, mm-hmm. but that doesn't mean that you need it. Mm-hmm. I use Acoustic Zen Matrix Reference 2, which is their copper, has like a purple jacket. Yeah. I use that point to point between everything. And then I use their Absolute Copper, which is a newer product. And I use that from the D to A's to the Avocet. So I've got two D to A's. There's a pre and a post. Third D to A being the Mitek.
Mm-hmm.
So that is a different version of their copper. How is it different? Is it better? It's not better. It's mm-hmm. only better in that application for me. It's a bit, the Absolute Copper is a bit smoother frequency curve through the low mids. The other copper has a little bit of a bump. It's a little more exciting. It has like a little bit of a low and almost like a high bump. And you know, is it measurable? I don't know. Is it harmonic distortion? I don't know. But I can plug them in. I can hear it. So it's Acoustic Zen, mostly the Matrix Reference stuff, and a couple of cables of this newer stuff, which is a lot more money, unfortunately. And that's from the DAs to the Avocet. And from the Avocet out to the amps, it's back to the Matrix Reference stuff, the purple stuff. Yeah, Robert Lee, he's a cool guy.
Yeah. Yes. Cool.
He was building amplifiers in college, and he was at this really fancy, I don't know what the name of it was. He's told me it's in Asia. It's where you go if you're going to be like the head of Sony. Like all of his peers from college are major players in the Japanese engineering world, you know.
Yeah.
And he was hearing that these different cables thicknesses and whatever were affecting this amp during an amp building project, and he brought it to the instructor, and the guy was like, "No, you're crazy. The cable doesn't matter. It's irrelevant." He's like, "No, you know, he played the cello his whole life. He was very in tune to harmonics and frequencies and the organic nature of music." He's like, "No, I really hear it." So his life ended up being not like running Mitsubishi, but making cables.
Right.
Because that's what he hears. And so.
Yeah.
But
cool.
Normally it doesn't matter. I mean, most systems doesn't matter. It's not resolved enough. It's not like any cable really matters that much. But when you're in a system like this, with monitoring like this, teeny half percents start to add up. You know? And then it becomes a thing.
Sure.
But generally, if the cable works, it works, is usually the case.
Yeah. Okay, so Gordon had one other question, and that is if you could, I'm gonna like back up for 1 second here. I'm gonna do this question, and then we're gonna play a game because we are live. We're actually gonna use that ability. And I want you guys to come up with the best question that you can for Brian in the next couple minutes. So I'm gonna have you answer this question. And then I think that there's a certain French hot dog chef that might be running around here. So I'm gonna go look for him while you answer this.
Okay.
And you guys come up with your question.
French hot dog.
All right, so the question is,
okay,
can you explain the qualities of a compressor that you use? And is it used in parallel?
Yes. The qualities of it. Well, it's a Class A discrete box. It has a lot of height, a lot of headroom. It's fairly clean. Now, clean doesn't exist. There's nothing like super clean, meaning like pure neutral. There is no straight wire with gain. It doesn't exist. Okay. So everything clean has a color. The alpha compressor has a very, very slight color. How could I explain it? I don't think I can. It's just a nice, to me, it's a pleasant, clean flavor. Do I use it in parallel? No, I do not. Parallel is a phase issue. The combining defeats the punch. It's not important to me to use it in parallel. I don't know if people are doing that in mastering, but no. I could, because it has the direct and the compressed, and you can play with the gain of both. Actually, it has a knob here where you can go between all compressed, all direct. So it has the ability to do that. I experimented with it when I got it. I didn't like it. At first I thought it was cool because I was like, oh, this whole parallel compression concept is kind of new to me. And I tried it, but no. I prefer not to parallel compress here. And if I was in your shoes, I would prefer not to parallel compress either. Because of the just the lack of punch that happens from that. But do what works for you.
Great. Oh, we have a guest.
Hey, come on in.
Good evening, children.
Did you make hot dogs?
No, I left my gear in the office.
Okay. So. Good to see you.
Nice to see you. This is cool. Lovely.
Yep. Thanks.
I've been listening from the outside. Looks pretty.
So we have 68 people.
It was more, way more earlier. Only the good stayed.
Right. Yes, I probably talk too much.
Oh, no.
I'm sorry.
It's just, you know, it's like 2 a.m. in Europe.
Ah, yes.
Some
bedtime.
Some people have to work.
Absolutely.
Absolutely. People that work is overrated, but some still do it.
Yes, yeah. It has to be done.
Great.
I'll be working tonight after we're done.
Oh, yeah.
Great.
Oh, yeah. While we have you here, mm-hmm. What's something that you look for in a mastering engineer?
Respect.
Yeah.
I spent
a good one.
And trust. Like I spent a long time on the mix. I deal with a lot of politics. I deal with insecure singers. I deal with the A&R's dog or girlfriend or mother opinion.
Yep.
I deal with all that stuff.
Right.
And I put it onto a piece of something that has the equilibrium where everybody somehow at one point said, that's cool.
Yep.
That's like walking on water, song per song. And then, and we have familiarity with the project, and it's like a 6-month project or whatever. Then you send it to somebody on the other side of the universe who doesn't know the name of the singer, unless you know you're mastering for the Stones.
Right.
And who has to interpret that. So I'm looking for respect for all that process.
Yep.
You know, and also I'm looking for honesty, which is very difficult to get from most mastering engineers, since it's really a service business, and so when you hire somebody to do something for you, there the balance between like, dude, your shit sucks,
right,
or here's your master is really hard,
right,
hard to mm-hmm. strike. So personally, I don't care. I want to know if there's a problem. Right. Because I really don't have that. My ego is placed in the music. So if I'm sending my track to a master engineer, and then as has happened once or twice in the last 10 years, I send my track to a master engineer and there's a gigantic problem. For example, like 3-4 years ago on a record I won't name to not piss anybody off, but it was Jazz. It was a singer, she was French. lovely. And my 650s, my Sennheiser 600s blew off. But they don't, they gradually lose their bottom. That's what they do. They sound lovely the first 6 months, then they start degrading. Mm. And I hadn't noticed that somebody worked in my room and blew them. Mm. Right. But they weren't blowing away when they went, they were blowing away where there was nothing below, like, I don't know, 80.
Right.
It was just stuck, right? And so I'm it's jazz, you know, so I'm not super focused on the bottom. And we had one day to track and mix the whole record. And so I checked, I do my cursory check on the 600s. I hear no problem. Send it to the mastering engineer. I hear nothing back. I hear the record, and I'm like, OMG, WTF, what the fuck?
Yeah.
Because I hear, no, listen, you, and I literally wrote the guy, I said, dude, you fucked up. That's not what I sent you. And then he wrote back, you sent it to me, so I thought that that's what you wanted.
Right.
So if you think about that phrase, you sent it that way.
Right.
That way, right there, the dude knows there's a problem. So I thought that's what you wanted, conditional past.
Right.
No, I'm not going to work with that person.
Yeah, we have to ask.
Yeah.
Hey, this is a little this or that, and I'm wondering, is this what you intended, or blah, blah, blah. It's that's what it
so
is.
So that stuff happened a couple of times, you know, you mix it in a different room or something. So I'm looking for respect on the, it's difficult. So I'm looking for respect on what I've done, but I'm looking for somebody with taste, who understands that when there's a 10 dB peak at 50 hertz on an upright bass, he should know that coming from me, it's probably something was lost in translation at one point.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Not easy to find.
Yep. We talked about that a little bit with the notion of service isn't slavery.
Yeah.
You know, and how much do you interject? You respectfully, you know, I mentioned a couple of cases of maybe questioning or, you know, when it need be. But and if they say, hey, that's it, then you say, cool, that's it. But but you have to do that.
I think it's dependent on the person. Like, you know, you after a while you start knowing who you work with.
Right.
So like, if we work together and I send you a mix that's whack, you're gonna say that doesn't sound like something that he would do based on the track record or the history. You know,
right?
And then you can decide to, or maybe based on my track record, it's like this is gonna be whack. I'm just gonna do what I can. You know, it's just a question of taste. That's why there's good and bad matches. You know, the first record I ever got mastered was my record, my first record, and it was done by Bob Ludwig in Maine.
Mm-hmm.
And I went up to Maine. It was kind of like, you know, I saved up for, I don't know,
years. Sure, you did the whole thing.
It was amazing. So I went up to Maine and I gave him the record, and it was done in my bedroom. You know, that the most amount of money spent on that whole record was on the mastering.
Right.
And I gave him the record. So we had no track record. We had no, I was 8 years old. You know, I mean, I was just starting. It was completely wet, very wet behind the ears. So I'm sitting in the back and I'm just looking to try and understand what's going on. And he turns around and he says, where did you mix this? I said, in my bedroom. And he said, wow, that sounds really good. I'm like, okay. So, you know, the level went down, the level of stress went down to the 2 dBs-ish. And then after a while I said, do you mind if I do things to this? And I said, well, I'd rather you do things because, you know, after you is the desert. And he said, well, you know, I'm gonna denoise this one. I wasn't super into the whole paying attention to noise at the time. And I said, I'm gonna add reverb on this one. I'm like, and then I told myself, I said, no, let the person who has fresh ears and a pretty decent track record take care of the thing. And then he sped one song up a little bit, like he very speeded it a little bit. And he was, because he has the bedside manners of somebody who's done, you know, half of the pop music of that era, it was, for me, easy to take. It's also a relationship thing, and a way you communicate.
Hmm.
But, yeah. For me, it's respect of the environment. But so anybody at the level of Brian will know what happens before the track gets here. You know, most of the time when I hear horror stories about mastering engineers crushing things or turning the stuff into what it's not, it's either people with less of a track record and ego problems who need to impart their own thing on it so that they feel like they justify the money, or people who have been doing it for too long and completely lost track of reality. That's been my two experiences with bad jobs. Mm. But usually it's ego driven. Mm-hmm. It's like, you're paying me $3,000, I'm gonna, you know, I have to do something, otherwise I don't feel like I've done something. Mm. And I've also had conversations with a bunch of engineers who said things like, I was like, wow, dude, well, you know, if I don't do something, then people feel like it's not worth the money. So they do shit. Yeah. And that is pervasive. But the thing is, to me,
I've never heard that.
Well, they won't tell it to your face.
Well, no.
But people talk to me, maybe it's the French thing. But the thing that I tell these people, I said, like, what's worth $3,000 is not the gear. It's not the speakers. It's not the work. It's the opinion. That's worth $3,000. It's the Chinese thing. You go to the doctor when you're not sick, and you pay them when you're not sick, right? For the mastering engineer, it's life insurance that the stuff is good, and then these days it's also, you know, all the level stuff and the evening between the songs. But to me, what I hire somebody like Brian for is to make sure that everything is as good as it can be. And so if he says, dude, everything's perfect, I've printed it flat, that's worth the money for me, because somebody spent the time, the energy, and all these years of practice and scrutiny and listening and referencing and just focus and discipline to get to this point where he has the boss to say, look, I don't want to touch this, it's perfect as is. That takes a lot of balls, because after him is nothing else. So for me, it's worth the money, no matter what, whether something's done or not.
Yeah.
You're hiring an expert for this one particular service. But it takes a while to get okay with that. For most people.
Yeah.
I couldn't hear anything because I was over there. So I'm going to have to watch this.
After. Yeah, or you can hear them. Questions? Or
Let's do one after very, we're done, very quick.
I'm sorry.
We can fire it up. No, you're fine. We can fire it up after we're done if you want.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'd love to hear the room, but I wanted to hear what you had to say.
It sounded
extremely reflected, so I'm going to go back and listen to that. Because I have that power.
Doesn't have to be a lot.
Someone.
Yeah. We're going to do a very, very quick question. So let's check out our stream here. And let's see. All right.
Yeah, stick around. May I have a seat?
I'm going to do this super quick.
Maybe let's close. Let's close that just gently. It's on casters. There you go.
Greg Boyd wants a hot dog.
That's no right. problem. What color?
Okay. I
want
like
a summon
one.
Bus. No, I don't want a summon.
Okay.
I'm good.
This is there's a couple good ones in here.
Okay. Let's do it.
All right.
Brian has to work.
No, yep. I'm fine. I work late.
You have a short commute.
I do. Yeah, you can sit down.
Is that okay?
Yeah, you're fine.
Okay. Thank you. Please describe the way in which you soft clip on A to D analog to digital conversion in more depth, and that's from deadscene.com.
Well, the most people with an analog desk have a A to D converter, which is able to handle a lot of headroom on the analog side. So the clipping artifacts that are bad usually come from the analog side, not from the clipping itself. So all I do is turn it up until I get it loud enough and make sure that there aren't frequencies in there that make it sound bad. In other words, it's a chain thing. It's not a special technique. The converter clips very well, as do a lot of really good, often Class A discrete converters. And that's what I have. I mean, the converter, you can't see it, but it's 3 rack spaces. It's this big. It has a 20-pin cord. It has a power supply that weighs 10 pounds. And in 1996, it was $16,000. So it's 2-channel ADDA. So it's just high headroom. And yeah, I mean, that's just it. I drive it. Now, part of the volume thing is really just frequency balancing. And that applies if you're in the box more, you know, even more so. But it's just a combination of getting the frequency balance right, the transient to compression balance right, and then driving the limiter until you get to that place where you say, okay, that's good enough to send it out. And I have sort of a place that I go over the years of knowing, and then if it needs to go louder, it can. If it needs to come back, it can, but it's not going to scare anyone away one way or the other. So it's not so much a trick, it's just this part of what good equipment can do. And those of us doing high-end work with nice analog chains, we're clipping a nice converter and maybe doing some other tricks with, you know, like I have the L2 for 1.4, but that's it, you know.
Great, yeah. And you did talk a little bit about that early on too, so if you want to see more on that, just rewind the video, the stream, before it disappears. Cool. All right, I think we should let you work.
If we're good, we're good.
Yeah.
We got through all the questions. And
I was able to read the comments. There's lovely people. Yeah. Got a lot out of the discussion.
I'm glad.
Yeah, great. Yeah, thank you so much for your time.
Yeah, I mean, my thing is, you know, I tried to say this in between everything we said, but I want to say it at the end because it's really the main thrust of what my life is about. Mastering to me is easy. Mm-hmm. What is the challenge is working with other people to encourage them to do great things. Mm-hmm. This is fun and easy for me. What I want is better records. I want people to be doing better things on the production end to bring out the uniqueness of the artist, to make a mix that's exciting, to not function by fear or perfectionism, but to function by musicality, to learn the frame of reference that we talked about with reference tracks, or eventually you learn your room with monitors, you know, to not say I have $500 for monitors, but to say I need a monitor that does this because currently I'm here and I need to get here. You know, to learn where they are and where they need to go with their chain, not just to buy things. So all of that is, that's what's interesting to me, is to inspire people to make decisions which are going to make the world full of cooler music and artists that are more fulfilled and more, you know, sort of manifesting their art, you know, through this crazy little two wires and driver thing that is our life, you know. Mm-hmm. So the music is this language of electricity in space and time, and so that to me is the challenging part. So hopefully within all of this mastering talk, some of that came across where people are inspired to do something differently that will make their productions that much more exciting and fulfilling for everyone who hears it and for them, you know.
Yeah,
that's what I'm about with every week with clients. And you know, I get a lot of questions, and I always, my answers are always along the lines of, there's no perfect mix, it's not my opinion, like, let's get you to be awesome and then we all win together.
Yeah,
you know, because then we're all gonna go up together.
Yeah. So yeah, that's something that's very consistent in all of your videos and the talks I've seen you do, so I'm really glad that we were able to kind of show that to some of the Puremix crowd.
On 2 days' notice, here we are.
Yeah.
Awesome. Thanks,
cool,
man.
Thanks so much. Cool.
Thanks, Brian.
Thank you. It's good to see you. And now we'll listen.
Yeah. Yes. Thanks for watching, everybody.
Bye-bye.
We will see you next time.